So thank you everybody for coming tonight. I was intrigued when I was invited to participate, and they when they invited me, they say that the theme was connections, and I was like, well, that's interesting. As many of you might know, in archaeology, there's been a lot of social network analysis, looking at connections between different communities, how we identify those. And that's not necessarily what I do, but I am what I would consider a disaster anthropologist. But first and foremost, I'm an archaeologist. And when they asked me to talk about connections, I said, well, connections are very, very important in disaster context, as you can imagine. And if you think about it, the thing that makes us human, and I might be biased because I'm an archaeologist and I study things, is, at first I would say, is our absolute reliance on material culture. But after that, I would say that we are social beings. Connections are what make us. It's what make our societies. And you can think about them from the interpersonal level to the household and the family level, within community, between community, all the way, if you think about today, international connections. We live in a global world. And actually, most of us, when we hear connections, we think something quite positive, right? Like, think about everything you can get now because we live in a global culture. Think about cuisine. I mean, we're at a Spanish restaurant eating tapas and drinking amazing wine. Fashion, which I'm quite partial to. Music and dance. And so connections are these great things. But my focus as a disaster anthropologist is long-term legacies of epidemic disease. And so what I also want to talk about is when connections might hurt populations, and the nature of the connections that do that. And this is a very timely topic. Every few years, you can think about the threat of a potential outbreak of a disease. Just last year, Ebola was in the news quite a bit. But also, there are other types of connections that hurt also. Think conflict, nations at war, and the threat of war. And so let's start to deconstruct that a little bit. So I want to kind of introduce myself. As Bill said, I graduated from the U of A in 2012, but I actually started my career as an archaeologist in the Southwest in the 90s, and actually at Homolivi. I don't know if any of you are familiar with Homolivi. And I loved it, but I'm kind of this happy, perky, silly, optimistic person, if those of you get to know me. And so most people find it strange that I study the macabre. I study massive death. I study disasters, things that are fairly depressing. So when I was at Homolivi, I loved being there, but I was always curious, well, why did people leave? And, you know, there are these oral traditions of, like, massive insect outbreaks. And, you know, I worked at the U of A Field School with, say, Barbara and TJ, and I loved being there also, but I also tended to be fascinated by things like the forest fires that plagued the area and the field school some years. From there, I went to Southeast Asia to study origins of complexity in Cambodia. And along the way, I stopped in the Philippines, where I experienced minor typhoons. With Cambodia, I found I was more interested in things like the impacts of the Khmer Rouge and the archaeology of the Vietnam War. When I was in Hawaii, I have one word, volcanoes, because who wouldn't be fascinated by volcanoes? And so you guys are probably wondering, well, how I work in the Northern Plains. I'm now a plains archaeologist. And most people are like, well, how did that happen? It was a total accident. I actually had a bike accident. I didn't have insurance. I needed a job. And Maria Nieves-Zedeno in the back hired me to work for the Park Service. And I said, okay, I know nothing about this, and I'll go. And I fell in love. Most people think the plains is this grassland, desolate area. It's not. It abounds with life. The cultures are beautiful and quite diverse. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a second. And as I was up there, I often wound up doing oral histories with different tribal communities, the Blackfeet, the Crow, the Mandan, Hidatsa, and Arikara. And what kept coming up over and over again in these oral histories of places like the villages, like the fur trade posts, where people kept talking about smallpox. And so the twisted part of my brain that meshes well with the perky, happy part of my brain went, why are people talking about something that happened 200 years ago? Why do they keep doing this? And so I said, hey, maybe I'll study this. And Nieves, Maria Nieves, Daniel in the back, said, yes, but only if you study it as a disaster. And that's kind of how this whole thing started. And so I've watched some of the videos of the archaeology cafes, and I've noticed some people have started them with dances. Other people have done other interesting things. So I want to, at this point, give you guys a quiz. So what I want each of you to do is close your eyes and bear with me. And I want you to picture three things with your imagination. The first is pretend you're looking at the Earth from space, like one of those beautiful satellite views. And I want you to imagine you're looking at a hurricane, the beautiful swirling clouds circling around the eye of the storm, and it's approaching the Gulf Coast. And it's at night, so you can see all the cities lit up beautifully, twinkling as the hurricane approaches them. So that's the first thing I want you guys to picture. The second thing I want you to imagine is a volcano with all of its amazing fiery red lava pouring out of the top, gas clouds, ash falling on the landscape around it, the cone kind of backlit against a beautiful sky. That's my second thing. And the third thing I want you to imagine is that you're in a pine forest and there's flames all along the underbrush, kind of crawling along the pine duff, eating the brush that's underneath, maybe moving up the tree trunks, the flames flickering, you can hear them crackling, maybe the heat. And that's the third thing. Now here's the quiz. I want you guys to raise your hands, and you can raise your hand multiple times. Which of these things that I've just described to you are disasters? Okay, who thinks it's the hurricane? Raise your hand. Okay, good. Who thinks it's the volcano? Okay, less. Who thinks it's the forest fire? Okay, probably even with volcano. What if I told all of you guys that none of those things are disasters? I'm sneaky. My undergrads hate me when I do this. But no, think they're all three of the things I described to you guys are natural processes and actually, or phenomena, and all of those things are actually, can be quite healthy parts of those ecosystems. Fire cleans out understory if it's quite regular, right? Volcanoes actually enrich the land with nutrients. And then hurricanes actually also can flush out wetland ecosystems and kind of restore those habitats also. And so what I want you guys to do, I am obsessed with like handouts and visuals, so everybody should have gotten a handout. If you didn't, please share with the person next to you. Look at page one. The things that I've described to you, and this is all very, it's kind of technical jargon, but this is the language that disaster researchers, social scientists, geographers, sociologists, anthropologists, and even managers will use to describe these things. The things that I described to you are natural phenomena. If certain things potentially threaten humans, their lives, or their property, they become known as what are called hazards. And so what you see in front of you is a table that's compiled from lots and lots of research. It's based on the work of many other people, and everything I'm going to talk about tonight is based on the work of many, many individuals. But if you look, you see that there's different kinds of hazards. And so the first thing you'll see are what are called natural hazards. And that's where your volcanoes and your hurricanes and your fires are going to fall into. And they can threaten human lives and human property. The other thing you're going to notice is something different, something that's called social hazards. And these are things that often were overlooked. So the hazards research paradigm basically came out of geography. It kind of started in the 40s and the 50s. A lot of National Science Foundation funding went into it. And they tended to focus more on the natural hazards. But social hazards are things like, you can think about Three Mile Island, Chernobyl, Fukushima Daiichi. These are things, those are actually disasters that resulted from technological or social hazards. But so humans can can result in hazards too. Now, at the very bottom of the social hazard box, you're going to see something that is very new for disaster researchers to think of. Prior to, I would say, 2001, most people would not have grouped things like conflict or terrorism into a hazard category. They would have excluded it completely. What changed in 2001 is 9/11. The other thing that happened is the government restructured the way FEMA, who handles most of the mass emergencies in the US and disasters, was put in the Department of Homeland Security. And so today we very much consider things like terrorism and other willful hazards as something that we should be paying attention to. Now, for those of you that really want to nerd out, if you look at the bottom of the table, you can see different elements of those processes. How predictable are they? How often do they happen? How frequent do they occur? And these are things that if humans live in these hazard-prone environments, we become used to them. And we can often perceive them and react in ways that help us what's called mitigate them so that we don't actually suffer any harm. So if you think, I live in Dallas now, we have hurricane sirens, and they go off all the time. Now, there is some interesting research that says that people that live in disaster or hazard-prone environments now develop what are called hazard subcultures. So you can think people who live in Florida and undergo hurricanes a lot, people who live in tornadoes, where they actually start ignoring the warnings because they become so normalized that they won't necessarily heed the warnings in the way that they should. But that's another point. So you might be asking, what is then a disaster if it wasn't the things I described to you and if I keep talking about these hazards? If you guys turn to page 2, I really do love my handouts, I can't help it. If you turn to page 2, I want to talk through this because we all have this common conception that disasters are things like an avalanche, a mudslide, like the one that just happened in Guatemala. And that's not what disasters are. Disasters aren't events. And that's how we've been taught to think about them, is that it's this thing, it's an event that happens, it affects people, and then they react to it and things start to change. A disaster is an event because those extreme process, the natural phenomenon that I was talking about, those can be events, but they're parts of natural ecosystems. A disaster is actually a process. And a disaster happens when you have a human population in a certain state of vulnerability, which means they're susceptible to be affected in some way, plus a hazard, so any of those things from that list I gave you guys, and it has to result in collective crisis, which means it has to be perceived by that community as something that has damaged the community in some way, either through loss of life, loss of property, or in some other way. Does that make sense to everybody? Okay. And so there's a knee-jerk reaction where we watch the evening news and we say, that's a disaster. I want you guys to, at all points now, be very critical of that. But, and this is something archaeologists have actually struggled with. Archaeology oftentimes has come very much out of a hazards paradigm because for us, we can identify large extreme events that happen near different communities in the past. So you could think in Mesoamerica, you can think of volcanic eruption. Well, you can think Sunset Crater if you wanna do the Southwest. And so we can study how communities may have moved in reaction to those things. And so there's a whole branch of archaeology that's devoted to volcanoes. That Mark Elson can talk about if he wanted to. There's a whole branch of archaeology that does seismic archaeology. It's very big in the Mediterranean where you detect earthquakes in the past. And that's a great thing. The thing is, disaster research, which didn't come out of geography, it came out of sociology, has been focused on something very different. And that has been the social disruptions that occur from specific phenomena. And so, how do people, individuals, and groups respond collectively to disruption? And for sociologists early on, it didn't matter what that disruption was. And this was it came out of the Cold War era, and basically what would happen in the US if a bomb was dropped. And what are called natural disasters became laboratories in which we could study human behavior under collective stress and see how people responded. And what we learned is that they didn't respond in these myth of disaster ways. It wasn't all panic, every man for themselves. It's actually people cooperated quite a bit. First responders are often the people who have survived the impact and pulled themselves out of the rubble, and they immediately go to helping other people around them. And so that's why a disaster is processed. It doesn't necessarily matter what that event is. If you look, you can see the impact period. That's what we get on the evening news. It's something's happened, people are affected, it's first responders going in, pulling people out, but that's only a small part of the story. So what we want to ask ourselves, especially if we want to help develop policy as archaeologists and anthropologists, is what are the big causes of disaster? What helps people avoid them? And if people do suffer from them, what helps them recover or cope with that collective trauma in ways that won't lead to ongoing trauma over generations? And that's the point. A disaster process can last for years, decades, generations. Katrina survivors in New Orleans are still dealing with the impacts of what happened. When things go on for very long periods of time, it becomes known as what's called historical trauma or multi-generational trauma. And there's a whole branch of psychology that deals with this. And so I study the long-term legacies of disasters, and the ones, the origin point for what I'm studying were smallpox epidemics in the Northern Plains. So before I get into my case study, the one thing I want to do, because this year's theme for the Archaeology Cafe is connections, is I want to talk about very recent research in from disaster researchers that shows why certain communities might recover more quickly and fare better in disaster than others. And it all has to do with types of connections. So I'm a terrible artist. I want you guys to bear with me right now. But there's an idea that types of connections basically related to this concept called social capital help people do better or even avoid disasters. And again, I'm a terrible artist, so bear with me. And so all of this comes from, this is in a beautiful book called Building Resilience. It's by Daniel Aldrich. I highly recommend it to all of you. It's pretty approachable. But what Dan Aldrich was doing is he looked at people who had survived the Kobe earthquake, people in New Orleans who had undergone Katrina. And those are very diverse communities. Think about New Orleans. There's different neighborhoods. Everybody talks about the Lower Ninth Ward and how decimated it was. But there are lots of neighborhoods within New Orleans, and some fared much better, not just because of proximity to the levees, but because of what Aldrich would call different types of social capital. Now, social capital it's a big fancy term, but basically what it means is it has to do with relationships or connections. And so it would be, my social capital is what kind of relationships I have with other people. Can I get them to help me? Can I get them to give me resources? And basically social capital can be built up over time. Think of things like trust. Trust is very important in these types of relationships. And so people have always said that social capital helps communities get over disaster. And Aldrich said, we should break that down into different types. And so what he does is the first type down here is called bonding capital. And bonding capital basically has to do with linkages between individuals of the same household. It's very family-oriented. It can be kinship-oriented, neighbors. So actually, the Lower Ninth Ward in New Orleans had a ton of what's called bonding social capital. Everybody knew everybody. They used to have what we would call ritual feasting in archaeology, but basically big cookouts, barbecues, crawfish boils, things like that. Everybody within this knows each other. It's like face-to-face interactions, right? Now, the next type is called bridging social capital. And these are basically groups at the same level. And so the best thing to do would be to think, you could think church groups, if you wanted, within a community, or different ethnic groups within a community, within a town, say. And so in New Orleans, this could be basically different types of neighborhoods. And so the Lower Ninth Ward had a lot of bonding capital, but did people have connections to people in other neighborhoods that would be these cross-ethnic or cross-group kind of connections? The third type does have a hierarchical difference. This is basically linking capital, and this would be government administrators, non-governmental organizations on the outside. So this is having ties to people outside or at a different level who can help bring in those resources, who can help you out. And what we're finding in disaster research is that you have to have all three. And you have to have trust and relationships of reciprocity in all three. And the groups that have that do quite well. Is everybody still on the same page? Okay. And so basically, Aldrich's thing is variation in recovery is a function of the quantity and the quality of these types of connections. Now, I want to switch to connections in North America. So this should be page 3, which I think is a beautiful colored map. I swiped this shamelessly from the Smithsonian Institution, National Museum of the American Indian, which is an amazing place for those of you to go. This is basically a map of trade networks in the west of North America. That's not to say there weren't any in the eastern woodlands. There are, it's just I only had so much space. The thing about this map, this is documenting connections between groups prior to European contact. And so what I want to drive home here is that we tend to think archaeology and anthropologists in culture areas. I'm a Plains archaeologist. My husband is a Southwestern archaeologist. But these are artificial divisions. And so groups in California, in the Pacific Northwest, on the Plateau, in the Great Basin, in the Southwest, and on the Plains, were very much connected socially and economically through these types of trade networks, which I think is an amazing thing. And you see that in terms of the exchange of trade goods. In the sites that I work at in the Northern Plains, we get seashells from the West Coast. We get native copper ornaments from the Great Lakes. I haven't seen turquoise. We don't get as much from the Southwest, although there are rumors in oral history of people bringing conquistador helmets up and blankets from the Southwest. And so it very much is possible. We know horses were moved across the continent after contact, as were guns, without Europeans ever having set foot in these areas. Now, these trade networks were amazing things, but they also were something that made people susceptible to a catastrophic disaster, which is virgin soil epidemics. When the Europeans arrived in the Americas, everybody knows 1492, Columbus sails the ocean blue, he lands in the Caribbean. The Caribbean was connected to the mainland through trade networks also. And it is possible that epidemic diseases immediately start getting transferred. People in the Americas did not have immunities to these diseases, and so everyone in communities could be affected, the very old, the very young, very healthy individuals. In the old world, these epidemic diseases, things like smallpox, were endemic. They were kind of always in the big cities, places like London and Paris, and so endemic means they're always there. They don't flare up and down. An epidemic is when something explodes and then it goes away for a while. And then it might come, you could have another epidemic. A pandemic is something that is very widespread. So in the old world, these were endemic diseases that became basically diseases of childhood. So you either got them when you were very young and died, or you survived and you had acquired immunity. What happens is, we know probably in the 1520s, diseases start to get introduced into the mainland. Now, for those of you, has anybody read Henry Dobbin's book? Yeah. It's an amazing work. It's Their Numbers Become Thinned. He belongs to me. Sorry. Their Numbers Become Thinned. And what Dobbin's did was something amazing. He showed that these epidemics could have wide-ranging, catastrophic impacts with millions of people being affected. And he's right at the scale of it is a catastrophe. A catastrophe would be a large disaster, something that changes the world as we know it. But what's come after Henry Dobbins' work has been other scholars who have shown that epidemic diseases in the New World didn't spread all at once the instant contact happened. Just like contact happened at a different pace, it happened in different places at different times in different ways. Epidemics probably affected different groups at different times in different ways also. And this is something that Russell Thornton, for those of you guys that might have read American Indian Holocaust, has pointed out. Where I work in the Northern Plains, contact with Europeans doesn't happen until very late. It's very different from the Southwest. The first record we have of somebody in North Dakota is 1738. That doesn't mean that people weren't there before. Given the nature of the fur trade, individual trappers probably who were illiterate probably went out, married into groups. So it is possible that people were there before. But so I just want you guys thinking about the fact that in the Southwest, exposure to epidemic diseases was probably much, much earlier than the area I'm talking about. That's one of the reasons I didn't actually do my dissertation in the Southwest, is we know that there was catastrophic impacts compounded then by Spanish colonial policies of converting people to Christianity and other things, or, you know, converting people for labor, taking people as slaves. And the Northern Plains, when Europeans do show up, it's in these trade relationships. And it enters them into this global world system. And I actually have historic documents for a lot of the stuff I'm going to talk about, as well as oral histories, to pair with the archaeology. And so it was a stronger case study for me to kind of study some of these things. So if you would turn to page 4, I will introduce you to the area that I work in. Has anybody been to the Dakotas to see? Have you guys seen the Earth Lodge villages? Aren't they amazing? I'm very biased, but it's so, there's hands in the back even too. So the thing about when we think of plains cultures, not everybody, but many people, especially in the US, tend to think of mounted, nomadic groups that live in teepees and hunt bison, like the Sioux. And there were mounted groups, the Crow, the Blackfeet, and the teepees were a form of house, and they're an amazing structure. They've had me put them up, and I'm terrible at it, but so I have a very deep respect for anybody who can put up a teepee. But there were other cultures too. They're Earth Lodge village groups. They were semi-sedentary, and when I say that, what that means is part of the year, they lived in these fortified, amazing villages on the major rivers where they grew corn, beans, and a variety of squashes. And then for part of the year, that's sedentism. Then for part of the year, they would go off on communal hunts for bison, because bison is inherently what a lot of plains culture is built on. But then they would come back and be in their villages. And so what you guys see on the page that you should be looking at is a painting of one of my villages that I worked on for my dissertation. It's called, it was the Awadiha village. The Awadiha are a subgroup of Hidatsa, and that's what they would have called as Awadiha. What we call it is Sakakawea village. You guys probably know the name better as Sacajawea. But it's Sakakawea. And so that's the middle village at Knife River. And so if these are in the Dakotas, Knife River is kind of up. I like that the Dakotas are kind of rectangular, so it's easy for me to draw. But you can see the tightly packed nature of these villages. That was done on purpose. Basically, in the late historic period, the Sioux become this kind of colonizing force, and they are trade partners. They also could, the next day, raid. So there was this fluctuating economic trade conflict relationship between them. And so having the houses spaced that tightly meant that it was kind of like an intentional chaos. If you lived there, you knew how to get around. And if you didn't, you would get lost quite easily. So it was a form of protection. They also had palisaded walls around them. if you look at the bottom of that page, any Park Service fans will recognize that that is actually the interior of a reconstructed lodge at the Knife River Indian Villages. It's slightly smaller than they would have been, but you notice that these are beautiful circular structures. They're timbered, framed, with a central hearth, and they have beds or dormitories around the outside. These are multi-family households. They're matrilineal, and so it would have been women, usually sisters. They're multi-generational, so the older generation, the middle generation, and the younger generation, all living under one roof. And so this has implications for how disease will spread through these communities. The other point to make about these communities is that they had matrilineal clans within the villages. So if you want to go back to that bonding, bridging, and linking capital, the houses themselves would have had been bonding capital. They would have been multiple, what we would call family groups, living under in one household. Those are the households. You could even extend that to kin-clan relationships within the village. Then linking relationships, you can think about as maybe inter-clan types of activities. The other things that these groups had were age-grade societies. And so this is men and women of specific ages, it would have been males on one side and females on the other, would basically buy into a society from that older generation, and they would get certain regalia, and they were supposed to do certain tasks. And so, for example, there was the Black Mouth Society, which was men of a certain age, probably their 20s, who functioned as the village police. The older generations had greater ritual obligations, but those are also forms of bridging capital also. I'm having a hard time applying linking capital to my case study because it's supposed to be this hierarchical difference, and that didn't really exist on the Northern Plains. And so what I've tended to do is apply it to inter-village but or more inter-tribal types of relationships. An important point for me to make for you guys is that in the Northern Plains, every village was its own socio-political autonomous decision-making group. So villages were like, they're like mini city-states without all the hierarchy. But this changes eventually. Because now we talk about tribes. Every tribe that I talk about, if I say Mandan, Hidatsa, or Arikara, used to be made up of sub-ethnic groups, and those were basically represented by villages. And so the tribal identities that we have today, I would argue, are a function of contact and smallpox epidemics and how people coped with that. So smallpox, if you turn to page, I don't know what page that is, 5, I went with a depiction from a Sioux winter count. The Sioux would basically be able to tell stories. These are mnemonic devices. Every year is represented by a little picture that would help the person who was going through that oral story or the oral history remember what happened. And in a number of Sioux winter counts, this is Crow Dog's winter count, you see people covered in spots. And so this is how people indicated that smallpox happened in that year. And so not only do we have the oral histories, but we have kind of the equivalent of historic records. We also have fur trade documents, explorer documents. I've gone through Lewis and Clark's journals. And so smallpox is a terrible disease. And I would show you guys, I would have put a picture of somebody with who had smallpox in, but you're having dinner and my husband talked me out of it. And I was like, that's probably a good point. But it's something that the tribes I work with actually want people to see because they're like, our ancestors survived this. People should know about it. But so I give you this. Smallpox, there's no cure for smallpox. It results from the virus variola major and variola minor. There are different severities. There are more severe forms. There are less severe forms. But the ones that affected the Northern Plains were terrible. We estimate that mortality rates could have been anywhere from 50 to 80%. It it's estimated that in some cases it completely wiped out functional communities, and they had to figure out how to bounce back from that in different ways. So the smallpox is also terrible for other reasons, which is that when you get smallpox, you basically feel like you have the flu. You get a very severe fever, and then you start to feel better. That's when you start to break out with the telltale pox. It mostly is concentrated on your trunk. It can spread to your extremities, your face. I hope most of you are done eating, but it can cover your eyes and blind you. The pustules can form in your mouth. It literally is a terrible disease. The other thing, though, is you can be contagious for many, many days, which means this is one of the diseases that, because you could be contagious for many days, as people moved, they could be spreading it without necessarily knowing that they were doing it before they got so sick that they couldn't move. Over time, as transportation methods sped up, the horse, for example, or in the 1820s, when you finally get steamboats, we're able to spread these diseases much more quickly. So I want you to turn to the last page. And now I'm going to walk you guys through the case study of how connections hurt. So these are all population estimates for the three main tribes that I work with. Now, I talk about, there are three autonomous tribes, the Arikara Caddoan speakers, so they're a totally different language family. The Mandan and Hidatsa are Siouan speakers, but also totally independent tribes. Each would have had subdivisions. What happened was, the first epidemic that I talk about is the 1781-82 pandemic. This was documented by Elizabeth Fenn. If you guys have read the book Pox Americana, it's an amazing piece of work. I highly recommend it. It basically, in 1781-82, smallpox spread across all of North America, maybe even farther south. At that time, the Mandan had been living in 9 villages or more at the Heart River here. So this was traditional Mandan territory. The Arikara had been in many more villages in South Dakota, at one point extending all the way down, but they had contracted for a number of reasons, probably earlier epidemics that we don't have historic records of. The Hidatsa were in 3 subgroups in this area. And these traditional territories, with the Arikara far the south, the Mandan in the middle, and the Hidatsa to the north, kind of stay as they move up. These divisions of Hidatsa farthest north, Mandan in the middle, Arikara in the south stay the same. But what happens is in 1781-82, the Mandan suffer such great losses. And prior to that, the reason we know they probably had earlier epidemics are there sites like Doubleditch that in the 1490s had a gigantic outer ditch, probably was a village of 2,000 people. At some point, it contracts. We don't necessarily know why, but the village has a smaller ditch. So this is ditch 4, this is ditch 3 in the 1500s. At some point later, it contracts again. This is ditch 2. And then just before, say, in the 1750s or so, Double Ditch probably only has 400 people in it and is a much, much smaller community than it was. This is one of the 9 villages that gets left in 1781 and 82. So what happens is, how do they cope? They start to rely on that Lincoln capital, and they move up here closer to the Hidatsa. And they basically then live in 2 villages, one on each side of the Missouri River. The Arikara are kind of always in trouble. They try to come up and live here for a time, but they get in a fight and they go off again. And they reform into a few villages right down here. Another big epidemic, because the fur trade posts start to get constructed in the 1820s. The steamboats come up river. Another epidemic happens in 1837 and 38. It's brought by the steamboat St. Peter's. And what this does is it completely decimates the Mandan. They estimate from a tribe that probably had 10,000 people in the 1600s, maybe 300 survive. the Hidatsa fare better for different reasons. But what they wind up doing is in 1845, they decide, and the story is much more complicated than that, but I'm summarizing it. They establish a village called Like a Fishhook together, the survivors. And eventually, the Arikara come, and after trying to have their own village across the river, they then, called Star Village, they get sacked by the Sioux. They all move into Like a Fishhook together. And that's where the three tribes live until the Dawes Act is passed in the 1880s, which is basically allotment and the U.S. government forcibly trying to remove the tribes. My point with this story is it's interesting to me for disaster researchers, because if it's the quantity and quality of bonding, bridging, and linking capital, after the epidemics, these groups did everything that they should have that should have increased their resilience to most types of disaster. The thing that they were doing, the reason they were moving this, wasn't that they perceived epidemics coming back. It's that epidemics so dramatically, the earlier ones, reshaped intertribal politics that groups like the Sioux became much more powerful and became basically a hazard in and of their own right from conflict. And so this moving here based on linking and bridging capital was in response to the hazard of conflict. What it did was it made these groups much more vulnerable to epidemic disease. Also because these were nodes in that pan-indigenous trade network. And so other groups coming were also bringing it there. And that's why they were hit so badly. The way that you see this in archaeology is you see, in epidemics, you see depopulation. You see population movement and amalgamation, that's groups coming together. You see socio-political changes, and you see a loss of cultural elements. So people always ask me, well, you're an archaeologist, how do you see that? And I say, well, I study pottery, and then they really stare at me. And I say, it's the everyday things that we make and use that can give us insights into things that aren't necessarily recorded in the written records. And so by studying pottery, I look at how these technologies change after these epidemics. And what I find is you can see that lots of people within household died. In the Hidatsa and the Mandan case studies, people had to purchase the rights to manufacture certain goods. Pottery was one of them. You were supposed to purchase the rights from an older person. They were supposed to teach you and give you that right to make certain designs. And after the epidemics, you see lots of designs fall out. And that's because those bonding networks, those within-house and kin networks, are so important to us, but they're also the ones that the diseases are going to travel through the fastest. And you get these basically technological bottlenecks where you lose all of that knowledge. And so you lose that practice. The other thing I see is in terms of bridging capital, people, in order to keep trying to do what they were doing before, because your workloads increase when all these people around you die, is they start cutting corners. So I see things like temper grinding. The temper is what you mix into ceramic paste. They grind crushed granite. They spend less time doing that. They spend less time thinning their vessel walls, but they're still making it. The other thing, though, is what I also see is I think that bond, that bridging and linking capital, they go to those other groups to get back what they lost. So if you lose everybody who can make certain things or has the rights to certain rituals and you don't anymore, you go elsewhere to try to bring them back. And so with their oral traditions that the Mandan and Hidatsa had actually transferred certain ceremonies to the Sioux that they had to buy back from them, but they were able to do it. Now, a lot was lost, but they were able to get that stuff back. And so my talk today has been about instances in which social connections hurt. But the other thing is we wouldn't be able to survive and put ourselves back together. So the irony is, even though in epidemics people suffered from these things, they put themselves back together by reformulating new types of connections. So that is my perspective.
Wasn't the ability to make the Roman-style arch lost in Europe for hundreds of years because of whatever happened in the Middle Ages and the diseases? And then it wasn't rediscovered again until about 1000, 1100?
So there was a lot lost. So the Middle Ages, so what you guys are probably thinking of, there have been a number of plague outbreaks. And people tend to think of the plague, oh, there's been a plague. Actually, what they usually mean is an epidemic, but in this case, bubonic plague is from Yersinia pestis, and it is a very specific disease. And so, yes, there were several outbreaks of plague. Huge numbers of people died. But in terms of what technology was lost, I can't speak exactly to Roman arches. I know, for example, Roman concrete has a number of properties that the modern engineers are starting to, quote, rediscover because they find it useful. There's actually a whole industry of going back and studying old technologies to see what they can do today. We can't ever estimate everything that was lost during the plague. So I can't speak specifically to the arches, but any time there's been an epidemic, you lose oral tradition, you lose folk practices, think of people, if you live in a house, the average population estimate for an earth lodge was probably, at a minimum, was 8 to 14 people. If your mortality rate was 50 to 80%, and 10 people were living there, that could be 5 or 8 people dying. And so you think of everything that you guys might have learned from your grandparents or your parents. If you haven't passed that on, that's gone. And so plagues throughout human history have taken, I like to make a this division between different types of disaster. I call some landscape disasters. That would be your volcanoes and your mudslides and things that maybe don't kill as many people, but they remove landscape places. So Sunset Crater is in northern Arizona is a good example of this, where you had volcanic eruptions that literally removed places where you could collect certain types of clays for pottery. And so people had to adapt. Where do you go when you find new stuff? But they could still make the things the same way. If you have a demographic disaster where lots of people die, you lose all of that knowledge. And those are, they're incredibly problematic. And so I can't even tell you what was lost. Like the 1918 influenza epidemic, for example, would have been another one that you could talk about. But yes. The Dark Ages and the bubonic plagues are terrible things. Yes. That is a really good question. So he asked how immunization played into my case study or the area or immunizations in general. No, that is an excellent question, and I meant to talk about it, and I just got so wrapped up in what I was saying I forgot to. So there is no cure to smallpox. Smallpox is one of the only diseases we've completely eradicated in the 1970s. Some of you might have been vaccinated for smallpox as children. You would have the telltale circular scar, right? The reason we stopped after the 1970s was we were worried about flare-ups happening again. Once it was totally eradicated, which the last documented case was in Africa in the 70s, we decided to, there's only a few places that samples are stored. They're guarded very heavily. But to answer your question, Jenner's cowpox it's not a vaccine, it's a variolation. You basically, he took a related, the cowpox, and you expose people to it, and they basically acquire immunity enough that they don't get smallpox. It existed, actually. It was developed in the late 1700s, and President Jefferson actually sent samples with Lewis and Clark on the Corps of Discovery. Now, Lewis and Clark wintered in 1804 and 1805. There's a reason my middle village is called Sacagawea's Village. It's because that's where she lived. And so Fort Mandan was built right here, just south of the Knife River. Now, Jefferson sent these samples with Lewis and Clark, intending that all the headmen, chiefs of different tribes would basically be given these so that they would acquire immunity to smallpox. But I don't know if you guys have ever seen a keelboat, been on a keelboat. They're terrible. They're open to the weather. And the early, Jenner's early strands of quote, vaccines, they were on little string cords. They were very hard to keep viable. And so Lewis and Clark got rained on, the elements were terrible, and they didn't last. So actually, lower stream groups did at first get
some, but not everybody in the villages did. And so by the time they got to North Dakota, they weren't. There are actually other, as forts are built up the river, other groups were tried to basically, quote, vaccinate them. It just didn't make it up as far as the Mandan and Hidatsa. Now later, they did, there are vaccine programs. I am a very firm believer in vaccines after studying my topic for as long as I have. And there may have been some, the Sioux may have gotten some vaccines earlier too, which is why they may have fared better. Mobile groups also fared better. If you look at the epidemiology of these old world epidemic diseases, they need really tightly compacted, high density places. So pueblos would be prime feeding grounds for many of these diseases. But remember how tightly packed those earth lodges were to keep the Sioux discombobulated if they actually got inside? That also meant that things that could be transmitted in terms of respiratory infection and things like that. Whooping cough was another big one. So pertussis, for those of you guys that know it. And then cholera also. But so these were prime feeding grounds because they were densely populated, people were packed together, and there weren't vaccines. But they did exist at the time, they just hadn't made it. This was really a frontier for people. Other questions? So Nieves, who is the reason I do all this, because she was my dissertation co-chair, asked what the modern tribes think about smallpox. So I've actually done oral histories, and to me, they see smallpox as an origin point. Like, it's if they had a modern origin story for the three affiliated tribes. If you guys look on the page with the map, you can see there's the Fort Berthold Indian Reservation. The Mandan, Hidatsa, and Arikara are three independent tribes, but they live on one reservation. I call them the Mandan, Hidatsa, and Arikara Nation. The origin of that modern tribal identity starts with the smallpox epidemics. But the other interesting thing is that the tribe, you know, when archaeologists have studied epidemics, and there's amazing work. I'm thinking Anne Ramanowski's Vectors of Death. There's Ref's amazing work in the Southwest. There's amazing stuff that's been done. We have tended to identify how many people have died and you know what was going on at the time. But the thing to remember is that the people I work with are the great-grandchildren, the great-great-grandchildren of the people who survived this, and there were survivors. And the tribe says that the reason they still exist today and the reason they made it through this is because they managed to hold on to their ceremonies and their sacred bundles and their traditions. But they do, the way it's been talked about, it's the modern origin point. And so going back to that kind of linking and bridging social capital, modern tribal identities, if the decision-making units were those individual villages, that begins to change after the 1781-82 pandemic. By groups deciding to live closer together, you started to see things like intertribal councils. So that's basically after 1781-82, you see it among the Hidatsa for the first time. And so that's the beginning of the Hidatsa tribal identity. The Mandan get incorporated, although sometimes there's conflict between those groups. But so it's a modern origin point. Is that what you?
Yeah.
Okay.
I just wanted people to know what
yes. So, but it's something they still feel is with them also. And so that's why if we treat disaster as process, then the smallpox disaster isn't over yet because they're still dealing with the ramifications of what happened and things that they lost. Yes?
Did they abandon any of their bundles because of the association with smallpox?
That's a very good question. So she asked if they abandoned any of their sacred bundles because of the association with smallpox. Not intentionally. It wasn't smallpox happened and they abandoned their bundles, which sometimes, and you see this in modern disaster context, people can either turn to religion to help them, they can completely reject religion because they feel like they've been abandoned, or new religions can form. So with the smallpox, because you purchase the rights to things, you purchase the rights to carry out bundle things. If those bundles weren't transferred and the owners died, there's scales of bundles too. So you can have individual bundles, and those get basically buried or disposed of when someone dies. But there were also village-level bundles. The Mandan especially had village-level bundles. If those hadn't been transferred, then they couldn't be used. And so they had to be disposed of in certain ways. But not because they had an association with smallpox. It's just because there was nobody to carry on that practice. And so that they did lose quite a bit that way. Other questions? So he asked about quarantine, if they knew at that time that quarantining was an effective tool. I think they did, because we have this very rich historic account, very biased, I would say, by Francis Chardon. He was running Fort Clark, which was the fur trade fort right next to the Mandan village, just south of the Hidatsa villages. And when the outbreak, when the St. Peter's came up in 1837, and basically the smallpox spread from there at the post stops at Fort Clark, they immediately start blaming him. One of the Mandan chief's forebears actually gets smallpox and dies. And the tribe blames the Europeans for coming. They know that this has been transmitted from the Europeans. And so actually the fur traders, we have this very rich history of them locked in the fur trade post because people are trying to kill them. But some trade does go on. But from those accounts, they say the Hidatsa have quarantined themselves and won't let anybody in. Now, that is just his account, and he tends to group a lot of people together. We know from oral traditions and so from some of the winter counts, for example, that some groups actually went off and established these, they seek refuge in traditional hunting areas like the North Dakota Badlands and things like this. So some people flee, and you saw that, so you would have epidemics would strike ancient Rome and people would flee the city, especially the wealthier who could do that, because people know you get away. That's a very common response in epidemics. And so one thing was people try to get away and basically remove themselves from the source of contagion. Other people quarantine themselves. There are accounts, like the elderly would be, no, leave me here to die. And they would quarantine, they would put themselves in their houses, and some of them actually didn't die. And so there was a very diverse response. But they do seem to understand that it's transmitted that way. There are some accounts that they also blamed artists for some of the epidemics. So that beautiful painting by George Catlin, George Catlin and then Carl Bodmer is another one, if you guys are familiar with Bodmer, had come in the 1830s, just a few years before the outbreak. And so some people refused to let themselves be painted after that. And this was actually an issue in the 1850s. Friedrich Rudolf Kurtz actually went up, the fort trade post moves from Fort Clark up to Fort Berthold, right by Lake of Fishhook. And he basically passes and he goes to Fort Union, which is another big fort trade post. And nobody will let him draw. They're like, if you draw, they will kill you. We will get in trouble. And so he's always secretly sketching. So if you guys look at the artwork of Rudolf Friedrich Kurtz, he's like secretly sketching people, and he shouldn't have been. But yeah, I think they did understand quarantine. It just wasn't very effective. Smallpox was endemic in the old world in places like Paris and London and became this disease of childhood. It wasn't in the New World. If you read Elizabeth Fenn's Pox Americana, epidemics sweep through Boston all the time. New sources get introduced through the slave trade. Like, there are all these different ways in which smallpox gets brought over, and you get these flare-ups. And so in Boston, they used to try to quarantine ships off the coast, and that didn't always work. So you have to remember that the fur trade is this, like, world system theory. This is a global economy, and there was still a profit to be made. So people were trying to quarantine themselves, and yet the fur trade post guys are sending people out to collect furs the whole time also. And so you see these re-exposures. And the epidemic goes on for months because of these little flare-ups. So.
When we were talking prior to your talk about your pottery study.
Yes. Yes.
Would you tell them about that? Yes.
So before I was, there's so much to talk about. So in my ceramic studies, because I am a ceramicist, I basically said, here's how disasters affect people. Here are my hypotheses, which I know if lots of people die, that will increase workloads for people. You see famines after epidemics. I said, people aren't going to have the same time. Now, this is during the fur trade era, and there are alternative European technologies. And so for cooking pots, clay cooking pots, you have metal containers that you can use. And so I was like, well, maybe people just give up the practice. And there has been a lot of discussion among archaeologists, especially that I think Waldo Weedle actually wrote that the introduction of the metal cooking container foredoomed the clay cooking pot. He was a very famous plains archaeologist. He was the neighbor of Emil Howery growing up. And so there's this link between Southwest and plains archaeology, two big figureheads. The metal cooking pots didn't foredoom clay cooking pots. They had very different properties. And what was interesting to me is I said, okay, maybe they'll adopt metal cooking pots. They don't have to waste their time making things. And if they don't, maybe they'll cut corners in other ways. They grind granite for their temper. That's, you sit around and you crush rock to temper your pots. You can use sand. I don't know how often I looked in Barbara Mills' lab through a microscope and you could see sand. You can just go pick up sand and put it in. And I was like, maybe they'll cut corners in other ways. They make their pottery by panel and anvil technology. And so to get something really thin, and Mandan pottery at the height was quite thin. I've measured stuff that's like 3 millimeters. And I've measured post-epidemic stuff that is very chunky. So I said, well, maybe they'll spend less time on these things, or maybe they'll just change the technologies. Maybe they'll lose the knowledge of, maybe they don't know where to get the right clays and stuff. And what I found was, and it shocked me, clay cooking pots persist for a while. The use of crushed granite temper is very tenacious. It continues all the way up until the last pottery is produced, which actually Francis Densmore documents pottery being made by a Rickett woman in the 1920s on the reservation, which is long after smallpox. They do get thicker, which some of that is skill. But the other thing I figured out is if you look under a microscope, the pottery was getting thicker. It could be that people were less skilled. Maybe the experts died. And the people who were doing it didn't know how to do it as well. Or they were spending less time. But that temper gets, it's larger, it's poorly sorted. They are obviously spending less time doing it. And so after the epidemic, there's an increase in labor because there are fewer people to do things, like tend to the gardens, to build the houses, to do all this stuff. The women kept doing it the way that they had been taught, but they were cutting corners. And I linked that with, I think women were reallocating their labor. So they were choosing, yes, we will keep doing this. We can't spend as much time doing it. But the importance of it is, I think it's tied to social identity. The other thing is, that granite comes, if you read the historic records and early ethnographic accounts, comes from sweat lodges. Pottery was seen as sacred. And the taking stuff from a sweat lodge, grinding it, and putting it in the pot is a process that's probably imbued with a lot of meaning. And so those practices continued even after the fact. But you can definitely see people cutting corners. And if you link that with all the historic documents and the ethnohistories, it's probably a response to epidemics. So microscopes are a valuable tool. We just don't. And nobody had looked at it in that way before. Yes, in the back. No, it took later for immunizations to reach the northern plains. It, you know, tribes establish relationships with the U.S. government in the plains through treaties, Fort Laramie, things like that. And so when you start, and there's actually the late 1800s is a time of Indian wars, especially with the Sioux. So as the fur trade winds down, fur trade posts actually get bought, dismantled, and the lumber gets turned into military forts. And so it's the rise of the U.S. Army presence on the northern plains. And so some groups, the Arikara served as scouts for the U.S. Army, whereas, you know, going out and fighting the Sioux, it's a very complicated time. Said immunizations don't really happen until much later. And if you guys look on that population chart that I handed out, the very last page, what I want you to notice is the 1880s is when the Dawes Act allotment happened. That in and of itself, the early reservation period was a very rough time for tribes. Allotment intentionally was supposed to take communal landholding and communities like Afishuk, which was the last traditional Earth Lodge village, and take those families and spread them out all over. And it basically breaks, they're trying to break up traditional practice. For groups like the Sioux that period, which the Sioux aren't on this chart, you see increased rates of things like tuberculosis, all kinds of eye diseases. The early reservation period is a very difficult time. So that starts to change in probably the early 1900s on the Northern Plains.
Kacy, thank you.